John chapter 21 this morning, and we're going to go ahead and read the whole chapter. I've titled this morning's message, The End of Self. I don't know. I think that my title goes with my message. I sure hope so. Nothing worse than a title that doesn't go with your message, right? All right, so we're preaching this morning, The End of Self. The main character we're looking at is the Apostle Peter and his life, and we're going to read in John chapter 21. To let you know just a little bit of background of John 21, the resurrection has already occurred. Jesus had previously told them, and we'll look at one passage of Scripture that talks about that, that he would go and meet them in Galilee. And while it certainly appears on the front end that the disciples are just going through and heading in the right direction and going along the course, there's really some hidden stuff in the Greek, according to one scholar, that really paints a completely different picture than what you get when you just read on the surface. And so I want to bring some of that out also this morning. But essentially what we have here is that the disciples have gone to the Sea of Galilee, and there they are fishing, and Jesus shows up in his resurrected form on the banks of the Sea of Galilee, and he begins to speak to them. And so let's start reading in verse 1. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. Just to make a point, the Sea of Tiberias is just another name for the Sea of Galilee, in case you didn't know it. And on this wise showed he himself. There were together Simon Peter and Thomas called Didymus and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee and two other of his disciples. Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a-fishing. They say unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing. But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then Jesus saith unto them, children, have ye any meat? One translation, or one Greek scholar made the comment that this could have really been translated in the English, in a newer form of English. We would maybe say, do you have any fish for us to cook or eat? And so he's asking the question, basically, do you have any breakfast? And so it goes on to say, they answered him, no. And he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, just as a matter of reference also, so you know who we're talking about, John the Beloved wrote this gospel, and he always refers to himself in the third person. He explains at the end of this chapter that he's the one that recorded all of these things. He was an eyewitness to all of these accounts, and he never calls himself John. He persistently refers to himself as the one whom Jesus loved. He also refers to himself as the one who leaned his head on Jesus' chest. And so basically, I just want you to know that John is referring to himself. So John's in the boat with Peter. And he says, or he's in the boat next to Peter, something of that nature. And saith unto Peter, it is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girt his fisher's coat unto him, for he was naked and did cast himself into the sea. It doesn't mean he was completely, I don't mean to be weird, but butt naked in the boat fishing, although maybe people have done that before. But what he was that he had stripped himself of his outer garment, and he was fit, and so he clothed himself in his outer garment, and I'm sure there's some spiritual implication there, but we're not getting into that. And then he jumped into the water. Verse 8, and the other disciples came in a little ship, for they were not far from land, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the net with fishes. As soon then as they were come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid thereon, and bread. Jesus saith unto them, bring of the fish which you have now caught. Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land, full of great fishes, 153, and for all there were so many, yet was not the net broken. Now, Will, I'm not really going to bring this out in this message, but I would like to make a point that the last time Jesus showed up and there was a fishing expedition that was taking place, he used their boat. They had been toiling all night long in the midst of the sea. They had not caught anything. Jesus tells them to cast their net on the other side of the boat. Amen. They end up pulling up more fish, really, than what the net can handle, really to the point that the net begins to break. Now the disciples have made a choice to go back, and we're going to get into it a little bit more here in a second. and they're attempting to catch fish once again. No success in the midst of the night, throwing their net on the other side at the Lord's command. Now the fish are caught in the net, and they know exactly how many fish there are in the net, and the net was not broken. I got good news for you this morning, amen. The Lord knows how to hold on to fish that he's catching, amen. And whenever God is in it, and we're putting the Lord first in the midst of our walk with him, he will not lose them. The net's not going to break because he's in control, amen, of the destination of the souls, but he's called us to be fishers of men. And that's when he first showed up and told them, he had called them also to be fishers of men. And there's an implication to that in the midst of this story. It's also interesting too that Peter's over here, and the last time we hear about a fire, he's standing by a fire denying the Lord, and then now he's walking up on the shore and there's a fire that's made that has provision for them in the midst of their tired and they're hungry and everything else. God, Jesus already has it all waiting for them to provide for them what it is that they need, amen. And you and I need to realize that God wants to do the same for us. He wants to provide for us as we continue to trust him and walk according to his will. It says right there that verse 12, Jesus saith unto them, come and dine. And none of the disciples durst ask him, who art thou? Knowing that it was the Lord. So right now, just with the wording and the way that we see, even though the sun now has come up, they don't recognize immediately that it's the Lord. It requires John, which describes that there's a level of intimacy, a level of close relationship between him and John. He's the one that recognizes. But even now for the scripture, for John, the Holy Spirit to speak through John and say that none of the disciples durst ask who he is, because now they all know he's the Lord, it means that they're having a difficult time at first, at least, discerning that it's him. They're not able to see with their physical eye. He looks different in his resurrection body. Amen. And there's multiple times that even Mary Magdalene, whenever he was first resurrected from the dead, and she saw him there at the tomb, she didn't recognize him immediately in his resurrected body. And so there seems to be some difficulty. He doesn't look exactly the way that he did before, but once you start speaking with him, even in his resurrected form, we see it even with the disciples on the road to Emmaus. They didn't even know who he was. They're sitting there telling Jesus, I don't know if you remember that story or not out of Luke, the disciples on the coming back on the road from Emmaus, Jesus had died. They had been following the Lord, and they're walking with him, and they're beginning to tell him, didn't you hear what happened in Jerusalem to the Lord, to Jesus? And Jesus begins to expound on them the scriptures from the Old Testament and begins to reveal to them the Old Testament scriptures that speak of him, and they still don't see him. And this has something to do with the message. The Lord's just given me this scripture, though, to share with you. They don't realize who he is until they're at the table and they're breaking bread, which is the form, which is communion, really. He's breaking bread with disciples. And the Bible says that whenever he broke the bread and he gave it to them, their eyes were open. Now, I'm telling you, in his resurrected body, he's still got nail scars in his hands. The way I know that is this. The book of Revelation says that whenever John the Beloved began to weep because nobody was worthy to open the scrolls, then one of the elders said, why do you weep? The Lamb of God, he is worthy. He has prevailed and he is worthy. He said, no, I'm sorry. He said, the Lion of the tribe of Judah is worthy, amen, to open the scrolls. And so John turns to look to see a lion, but what he sees is a lamb as though it had been slain. He bears the marks in his body, and ever-present reminder of the high cost that it required in order to redeem humanity and reconcile lost sinners unto him. The point that I'm trying to make is this, and it's really going to be my first point later on, is that you got to be able to see him. And they're having a hard time seeing him. And really and truly, not only do you have to be able to see him, you also have to be able to see his work. And their eyes were open when he broke bread and they saw the nail scars in his hand. And immediately, the Bible says, regarding the disciples that walked with him on the road to Emmaus, he disappeared. His resurrected body is different. His glorified body is different than our physical bodies, different than his physical body previously was. He's not restricted logistically. Walls can't hold him, amen. And he was one place one minute, and he was somewhere else the next very second. But yet now their eyes have been opened to who he was and also to the work, amen, that he had accomplished. And so I just wanted to make the point that they're having a hard time discerning him and seeing who he is. Verse 13. Jesus then cometh and taketh bread and giveth them, and fish likewise. This is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? Now, does anybody, have you ever thought when you were reading this passage of Scripture, what is Jesus talking about? More than these what? Do you ever stop and think when you read? I know when I first got saved, I didn't really stop and think a whole lot. I just read, man, I read two chapters today. I don't really know anything about what I read, but anyway, I read two chapters and I got it done. Now, I try to stop and think, you know what I'm saying? Now, like, slow down a little bit. What is it? I mean, have y'all ever thought about that? I mean, I'm not trying to, you know. But does anybody have any idea? You can shout it out if you do. That's a good one. Scholars are really divided, to be honest with you, on what exactly Jesus is talking about here. One of the main ones has to do with the disciples, and I'll show you a passage of Scripture why. In other words, Peter's over here. He's made comments before in the past. Right. They may not love you like that, but I love you like that. But also, one scholar that I really, really read behind a lot and I really respect him, he thinks it has to do with the fish. Simon Peter, do you love me more than these? Because something's going on in the text that we haven't covered yet, that Peter has made a determination in his heart and he's gone in a direction that he really was not supposed to go. And so the Lord is trying to question, but I'm going to be honest with you, either way, the truth still holds. Whether it was the other disciples or whether it was those fish, something was drawing Peter. Something wasn't right with Peter's heart. And he was really, even though he would look like he was going in the right direction because he was going to Galilee and that's where the Lord was going to meet him, something's not right. Amen. All right. So he says right there, and he had asked him if he loved him. And I'm really not going to get into the differences in the words of love here, but just so that you're aware, two different words of love in the Greek language. There's at least five words regarding love in the Greek language, but two of them are used here. And the first one is agape love. And it describes when you get a revelation of how, like, it's God's form of love and it's sacrificial in nature, but in order for a human to be able to have that type of love, that human being has to have a revelation of how precious the object is that's being loved. It's a selfless type of love. And in reality, human beings can have that type of love towards even another human being and even towards, but specifically it's supposed to be that way towards God. But you'll never have that type of love if you don't have a revelation from God the Father on what agape love truly is. It's bigger than just phileo love. And when Jesus asks him the first time, he says, Simon Peter, do you agape me? And Simon Peter's response is, Lord, you know that I phileo you. And you got to understand where Peter is in the midst of all of this. Remember, he was standing by a campfire and he denied the Lord three different times. And then Jesus goes and he's crucified. And, before in the Garden of Gethsemane, Peter tried to prove his love for the Lord in his own way. I didn't put that passage of Scripture in here, but you'll remember that there was a servant named Malchus of the high priest, and he was part of the entourage that went to go get Jesus. And Peter took his sword out of his scabbard and he cut that dude's ear off. And so in Peter's mind, he's like, I'm telling you right now, I love you and I'm going to live for you. And everybody else might be offended by you and they might run, but I'm here to stand and I'm going to prove it. And he took that sword out and he cut that old boy's ear off. And so we see that Peter definitely had devotion to God, to the Lord. He definitely loved the Lord. There's no question about it. But his mindset, his understanding of God and the things of God and how the kingdom of God was supposed to work was all skewed. He didn't really have a revelation of how God's kingdom was supposed to work. And he didn't really have a revelation of the love. And so Jesus goes on to say, again, he said to him a second time, verse 16, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Do you agape me? He said unto him, yet Lord, thou knowest that I love that I love thee, that I phileo you. He saith unto him, then feed my sheep. So Jesus is getting his mind directed on what he's been called to do. Amen. He's been called to be a fisher of men, and he's been called to be a shepherd of men, to nurture, to feed the sheep of God, the word of God. Amen. And he goes on to say in verse 17, he saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, do you phileo me? And Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, do you phileo me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. I try to put myself in Peter's situation. And if it is, do you love me more than these? And if it's those fish. And I imagine Peter being there with a broken heart after he's denied the Lord three times, after he's made all of the claims that he made and boasted about what a powerful follower of God that he is, and that he himself ran from the Lord. He himself denied Jesus three times before the rooster crowed. And now Jesus is saying, do you agape me? But then finally he comes down to, do you phileo me, Peter? I mean, you know, sometimes we got to ask our own selves. I mean, are your actions really reflecting the words that you're speaking to me? And I can see him looking at them, some of those fish bones or those fish that maybe still are on the fire, and just contemplating all of the things that have taken place in his life here recently, in the last, you know, the ministry, the time that he walked with the Lord, and then recently over the last week, all the events that have taken place as he ponders, you know, where he is and the things that he's done. And Jesus has a purpose here. Jesus is definitely desiring to get Peter's mind right, to get his heart right, because God has a purpose for Peter's life. Peter's been called to be a leader in the church, amen. And now we're moving to the next phase of the announcement of the kingdom. I mean, Jesus' arrival as the Son of the Living God is the presence of God showing up. This begins and institutes the last days of humanity. I mean, this is the beginning of the last days. God had been promising that he would come. He showed up, and now he's not only died, but he's resurrected from the dead, and he's about to ascend to the Father. The Holy Spirit's about to come. And these are the very people that God has chosen to be utilized in order to spread the gospel message so that the truth could go forward and that people's lives, amen, could be changed. All right, he goes on to say right here in verse 18, verily, verily, I say unto thee, when you were young, you girdest yourself and walkest wherever you would. So he's basically describing Peter and how he was. When you were a young man, you put your own clothes on and you did whatever, you walked wherever you wanted. You did what you went where you wanted. But when you shall be old, you shall stretch forth your hands and another shall gird you and carry you where you would not. Verse 19, this spoke he signifying what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. Basically, what Jesus was saying is, you will be crucified for me. You will die for me. I mean, by him stretching out his arms, he's talking about crucifixion specifically. Church tradition says he was crucified upside down. Some people question that. They say, no, that was Simon Mangus, the sorcerer. I'm not here to argue that point. I know that he had to have been crucified, because of the way Jesus described his death right here. But people say in the church tradition that he said, I don't want to be crucified the normal way. I want to be turned upside down because I'm not worthy to be crucified like my Lord and Savior. Verse 19, this spoke he signifying of what death he should glorify God. And when he has spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. Then Peter turning about, so that's the last thing he tells him. He says, follow me. Then Peter turning about sees the disciple whom Jesus loved following, which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? So here's John walking behind, and Peter recognizes. So Jesus and Peter, and this is the way I see it, Jesus and Peter have been by the fire. Now they've gotten up, they're starting to walk, and all of a sudden Peter looks. I don't know if he sees him out of the peripheral, but he sees John right there following him. And John turns around, and he wants to know, which is the one that's going to betray you? And what Peter in verse 21 says, seeing John, says to Jesus, Lord, what shall this man do? So here's Jesus having to sit down with Peter, and then he sees John walking behind, and the first thing Peter wants to know, yeah, but what's he going to do for you? All right? And it says right here in verse 22, Jesus saith unto him, if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. Then went this saying abroad among the brethren that the disciple should not die, meaning John. Yet Jesus said not unto him, he shall not die, but if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? This is the disciple which testifieth of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. And there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, everyone, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Wow. Amen. And so, once again, I titled this morning's message, The End of Self. And really, if we review the life of Peter, we see repeated situations and actions and phrases that take place time and again that show us that Peter had an issue in his own personality, in his own walk, like every single one of us in this room have. When all of a sudden, when we become spiritual, I know it happened to me, you know, when I became spiritual. Y'all know what I'm talking about? When I got a revelation. And all of a sudden, I'm like, man, I think I wouldn't have told you this, but I think I'm a little bit more like the Apostle Paul than I am Peter. But the reality of it is that we all got Peter in us. We all got a level of Peter in us that needs to die, that we need to come to the end of self on. And when we look at some of these statements that Peter made, I got a lot of scripture for you this morning. The next place I want to go is in Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 25. And this is a very memorable passage of scripture. All of you are familiar with this and Peter's life. Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 25. It says, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He says unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, you art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. And so in this first passage of scripture, we see that Peter has a revelation that he's been given from the Father. Amen. Jesus wants to know, who are people? What are they saying out there? Who do they say that I am? Well, they think you're one of the prophets revisited. They think you might be Elijah. You might be Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. And Jesus asks his disciples, but you've been with me. Who do you say that I am? And Peter's the one that steps up. He says, you're the Christ. And we've talked about what that word means on multiple occasions. It means you're the anointed one. You're the promised one. You're the one that we've been waiting for. And you're the Son of the living God. And Jesus says that flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. You didn't learn that just from reading the scriptures on your own. You didn't learn that through anything that you knew. No man could have told you that. But my Father in heaven has revealed to you that I am the very one that you've been waiting on. And I know that I've mentioned this to you before, but the word rock is used twice in the Greek right here. Peter's name means rock. And also, when he uses the other word rock, it's a bigger rock. And so Peter's name means a little rock. And when he says upon this rock means a big rock, what Jesus is saying is upon this rock, upon the revelation that you just spoke, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell are not going to be able to prevail against my church. They're not going to be able to prevail against the foundation that I'm building my church on, which is the truth that I am the anointed one that God has been promising you from ages old through all of the mouths of all of the prophets, giving you revelation as the people of Israel that I was coming, I am here, and I am here to defeat the forces of evil. And through revelation of this, people are going to be able to walk. Now, there's a lot to be said about binding and loosing. I will tell you that that sometimes some people would say that, you know, they'll take the opportunity. I didn't plan on teaching on this, but I'm just going to go ahead and make a comment about it. That binding and loosing has to do with us binding things that are spiritual and that we now see it bound also on earth. Personally, for me, I think that there's some truth to that. But I will tell you that the literal interpretation of Old Testament times was that the Pharisees interpreted the Old Testament scriptures, and they made the determination on what they thought would be binding upon the people regarding the scriptures versus not binding and where they could be loosed. And so in a literal sense, what's happening here is that God is telling Peter that now the disciples will have that revelation as far as what's going to be bound through and given revelation of scripture upon the people. But I'll tell you something else. in the context of what he's talking about the gates of hell. And he's talking about the power of the forces of evil. And he's talking about the fact that his church, his people, are going to be able to operate based upon the foundation of what God has provided. And I'll say this, that also in the Old Testament, many of the Old Testament prophecies that were prophesied were fulfilled through the words of the disciples as they spoke, but they were quoted a little bit differently than what they were in the Old Testament. And many scholars tried to say, oh, well, they said something the wrong way. They quoted it wrong. No, the Holy Spirit gave them greater revelation. It's not just the same that it was in the Old Testament anymore. There's added emphasis and added thought to it. And I believe here that because we're talking about victory, and we're talking about salvation, and we're talking about the church being built upon the rock of the foundation of Jesus being the Christ, that in Him, through Him, that yes, we have authority in Christ to be able to go to the Lord and to be able to say, Lord, according to your word, that this would be so. We have victory in you. We have power in you. And we need victory down here on this earth. Amen. And God will give power to his people. God will give power to his church. And so he's telling Peter, he's encouraging him, and he's saying, you got a revelation from God on that. But look, just in the next paragraph, it says, from that time forth, began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go into Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. So what I want you to see, though, is this, is that the connection in this passage of Scripture, I don't know if I've ever seen it like this exactly before, but here he's talking about how he's going to get power to the church, how he's going to give power to the church that the gates of hell are not going to be able to prevail against it. Amen. And then the next subject that he talks about is his death, burial, and resurrection from the dead. They don't understand right now in this premature level of their understanding of what Jesus has been telling them, the magnitude of what Jesus is about to do when he goes to the cross. I've preached to you multiple times about Matthew 12 and about how the Pharisees accused Jesus of casting out devils by the prince of devils, Beelzebub, but by Jesus saying that if I have cast out devils by the hand of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you, and that you don't try to take the spoil of a man's house till you first bind the strong man. And the way that Jesus came to bind the strong man, who's he talking about? He's talking about the devil. The Greek calls him Hapaniras, the evil one. And how do you bind him? Because Jesus has the power of the kingdom resident in him. And the devils and the demons shudder and shake when he shows up in the midst of a situation. And now his whole purpose coming on this earth is to announce the kingdom to us and then to offer his life and payment for the penalty of sin for us. And then the very spirit that raised him from the dead now becomes resident in our mortal body, and the very power that God, that Jesus operated with, is also living and alive within us, amen, and he gives us authority over the forces of evil. So now Jesus is just going on, and he's trying to explain to them how it is that he's going to get this power to them. I'm going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to suffer at the hands of the Pharisees, and I'm going to die, and I'm going to be buried, and I'm going to resurrect again. And Peter's response is, Peter says, be it far. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him. I mean, you see Peter's attitude here. I mean, surely you mean well, dude, but you're talking to Jesus. He begins to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee. See, but I just want you to see that things aren't going the way that Peter expected. Let me give you a little insight on Peter. He's pretty close to being what they call a zealot. What that means is that there was a whole group of Jews at that time. They were waiting for Messiah to come, but all they understood regarding Messiah was all of the Old Testament prophecies that spoke of the fact that he was going to be the eternal king. You remember that? About how there would be a king that would sit on David's throne forever. About the fact that, you know, all of the nations would come and bow in Jerusalem as the king sat upon the throne. Remember all those kind of Old Testament scriptures. So the Zealots were a group of people that were sick of Roman dominion, sick of the fact that they had been slaves, if you will, to previous nations. And they're waiting for Messiah to show up and to make things right. No, we're the people of God, and it's about time for us to get paid. We're ready for our leader to show up, to take the throne, to kick Rome out, and for us to have our freedom as a nation. But in reality, and so Peter was very close to one of these, and Peter's got his own mindset on the way things ought to go. You understand what I'm getting at? It's important that you understand what I'm trying to say right now. You know why? Because when you come into the kingdom of God and you start to get a true revelation of Jesus Christ and what he's done for you, guess what you're going to start to realize? Christianity isn't exactly what you thought it was. I'm telling you right now, when you first come in to Christianity, we have our own mindsets and our own thoughts on what things ought to look like and the way things ought to be. And he's over here trying to tear down our preconceived notions and all of our wrong thoughts and all of our wrong ideas. And he's trying to now put in us the truth, amen, of what the gospel really is and what it'll do in the midst of your life. And guess what? Sometimes you're like Peter and you don't like it. Come on, can I get an amen? Sometimes you're like Peter and you don't like it. And let me tell you something, you may get to the point where you're like, you know what, if this is what it is, and I don't want none of it. If this is what it is, and I'm turning away, and I'm going to go back to what I used to do. Come on, somebody, help me out here. You know that the enemy, if he tries to whisper in my ear sometimes, I know that he's whispering in your ear too. Not that I'm, because I'm something more special than you, not at all. But I've been in this fight for a little while, and I've seen some of the tactics of the enemy, and I'm telling you, if he's whispering that garbage in my ear, he's whispering it in your ear too. It ain't going the way I wanted it to go. It's not happening the way I expected it to be. Okay. He says right here, right, then Peter took him and rebuked him, and this shall be, but he turned and said unto Peter, this is Jesus now, get thee behind me, Satan, you are an offense unto me. The word offense is a scandalon in the Greek. It describes a green tree that's set as a trap. You know what I'm saying? Back in the day, they'd have a trap in the middle of a pathway to try to catch an animal when you'd come through there. Jesus saying, Peter, you're an offense unto me. You're like a trap that's set in the pathway of the place where I'm heading, and you're about to try to trip me up. You're a stumbling block. You're an offense. You're standing in the way of God's plan for my life. And he says, you don't savor the things of God. You savor the things of men. You want things done your way, Peter. You want things to happen in your life that are going to make things conducive to you. You don't have a vision of the big plan of God. You're so focused on yourself and what you want, you can't even see what God's really doing in the midst of all of this. See, the enemy did the same thing. He tried to exalt himself above the throne of God, and now, because he had his own idea on the way things ought to be. He, full of pride, he tried to exalt himself above the ways of God, thinking that he had a better plan than God, and now he does to try to do the same thing in men's hearts and minds each and every day as we walk this journey. He tries to put in our hearts and minds. He uses us as a vessel to try to thwart the plan of God. And he's trying to use Peter as a vessel. And the Lord rebuked him and said, called him Satan, because he was savoring the things of man and not the things of God. You understand that the enemy uses man to try to come against God's kingdom. He says this. And this has to do with the title. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. You know, the cross is an instrument of death. It kills things. Amen. He's saying right here, if you spend all of your time upon this earth trying to find your life, that's why I got such a problem with that book that guy wrote in Houston, Your Best Life Now. I mean, that's just contrary to the scripture. He's over there trying to tell people, I'm not going to get into all that, but the point that I'm trying to make is that if you are spending all of your time focused on trying to get your best life now and not understanding what the scriptures really say about denying self now, understanding that there's an eternity to gain. I mean, is it real or is it not? Is it true or is it just a fable that we're reading here? Have we seen the God of glory show up in our life and change us? Amen? I mean, surely each and every one of us, you know what I'm talking about. That there's things upon this earth that you tend to have a desire to take a detour, to go after. Things that you think are going to bring you happiness and fulfillment and joy. And the reality of it is that Jesus is saying, no, you're going to make a choice. You're either going to deny yourself and you're going to let self die. Or else you're going to go ahead and try to grab a hold of that. And the result is going to bring destruction into your life. He said, and so what I wanted you to know is that he can't, you know, Peter is going against his understanding of what Jesus is saying, is against everything that he desired and everything that he would have thought would have been the way that God was going to do things. But in reality, it's not. It's not the way that you think it's going to be, Peter. And really, you must come to the end of yourself. Amen? And there was another passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 26. So in that passage of scripture, basically what we just reviewed, Matthew 26 verse 32 is where we're going next. But in that passage of scripture that we just reviewed, the main thing I wanted to get out to you is Peter's mindset. His understanding of things is wrong. It's skewed. He thinks things ought to go a certain way, and in reality, they're completely contrary to the ways of God. And I guess I'm just trying to share with the people today, and for the preacher today, that many times our way of thinking is contrary to the ways of God and contrary to the plan of God. Amen? All right. Matthew 26, verses 32 through 34. He says, but after I am risen again, I will go before you unto Galilee. Peter answered and said unto him, though all men shall be offended because of thee, yet will I never be offended. Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, that this night, before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. You will deny me three times, Peter. You know, before we got a revelation of how Peter and his understanding was contrary to the ways of God, now we get a little bit of a glimpse in Peter's heart and what he thought about his own Christianity. Peter really thought highly of himself. You understand what I'm saying? He was superior. When he looked at the other disciples around him, he said, that one, I've been knowing he was going to offend you, because I can tell right now, see the way he walks. And the reality of it is that he is not really sold out to Jesus the way that I'm sold out to Jesus. I just got an announcement to make. Everybody needs to understand something. They might all offend you, Lord, but I'm with you to the very end. I'm going to stick this thing out to the very end. I'll never be offended by you. And Jesus says, no, really, what's going to happen? Let me let you in on a little secret, Peter. You know, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three different times. And so we find out that in reality, that sometimes also for ourselves, we think pretty highly of ourselves. We think pretty highly of our Christian walk. We look around at other people and we determine in our hearts, boy, I don't do that. I don't do that with anyone over there does. Boy, I'm superior to them. And you're not going to sit here and share that with somebody, right? But that's what we think sometimes. I'm telling you right now, a self-righteous spirit is in the hearts of the believers, even the ones that love God with all their hearts. And they begin to review, and they're like, I don't do that kind of worldly stuff. Them people love the world. And this one and that one. Well, that's good. I'm glad you got free from that particular thing that you're talking about. But you might not have ever really liked it before to begin with. And I know I said something like that last week. But the point that I'm trying to make is this. Is that Peter, he feels superior in his walk. He's got he thinks something of himself that he's really not. And I think that if each and every one of us was able to really see really just how we were as Christians, that we would realize we think more highly of ourselves than what we ought to. Amen. And but God understands that. He knows how to work things out in our lives. But one of the things that I wanted to tell you too, to go back to John 21, is the fact that the interpretation of one Greek scholar, where it says in John 21 where we were, where Peter says, I go a fishing. That the idea behind that passage of scripture isn't just a little fishing trip. But that in reality, what Peter's saying is that I'm going to make a break from where I am now, from the connections that I have, and I'm going back to my former way of life. And it's because he's denied the Lord. Even though Jesus has resurrected, he's denied the Lord. He doesn't understand everything that's going on. He has a certain view about himself and others that's not right. And he's now willing, at this point, to break away and to go back to what he previously knew. And so, but then the real problem is that there's six other disciples that have heard what he said and now have said, we're going to go with you. And so what we see here is that, yes, they end up in the right place, but the reality of it is that their heart isn't right in the midst of this situation. And so what I wanted you to realize that, and he brings these other six disciples with him. One of the things that I began to realize is that the enemy of our soul, he's already changing his tactics. You understand what I'm getting at? Because what's happened is that he tried, even though he knew various aspects of the gospel, he knew that the seed of the woman was going to crush his head. He knew Isaiah, Psalm 22, that Messiah would be pierced. But because of his own deceitfulness that he has, that he's deceived because of sin, I know that he wasn't able to understand the whole covenant and the whole way that God was going to gain victory over him. Because if that would be the case, I don't think he would have ever put Jesus on the cross. But yet at the same time, I know that spiritually he's over there causing Rome and causing the Jewish people to come together to put Jesus on the cross. But now something different has happened. Something that he's never seen before since he himself failed. And he's never seen this before. And what he saw now was this, is that sin didn't have dominion over this man named Jesus. Every other time it's worked. Whenever I brought sin into the angelic race, they all fell from the presence of God, and none of them have ever been able to get back into the presence of God. Then whenever I put sin into this weak little human race, every last time their feeble little bodies have succumbed to death. This is the first time that he's ever seen a human body die, but resurrect from the dead. And I'm telling you right now, he's already strategizing and he's already planning on what do I do now? How do I change this? How do I fix this situation? Things are different now than what they've ever been before. And immediately he goes towards the disciples, the ones that he's been watching Jesus train for all of these years, telling them that they have a purpose. He heard Jesus pray the prayer of John 17, where Jesus says that I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but instead I'm asking you to keep them here, but I'm asking you to keep them from temptation. I'm asking you to use them just like you used me. He heard all of that, and immediately what he's trying to do is thwart the plan of God, come against the disciples of the king, and trying to ruin the whole thing. And here they find themselves in the midst of this situation where they are at the Sea of Galilee. Now, what I want you to know is this, is that if we're going to come to the end of ourselves, and we're going to operate properly in the kingdom of God, there's at least three different things that I found in the John chapter 21 passage that I wanted to share with you real quick. Number one, if you go back to John 21, verse 3, really verses 3 and 4, it says, I really wanted to look at the last part of that passage. But Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a fishing. They say unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing. But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. And we read the story already, and we realized that John then realizes that it's him. Now, one of the main things that I want to point out to you, point number one is you have to be able to see him. Not only do you have to be able to see him, but you also have to be able to see his work. What I'm trying to talk to you about right here, point number one, is that we need a revelation. We need a revelation of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. Amen? And the word night being used there, whenever we studied the Gospel of John a long time ago in the Bible study, something became very apparent. John uses the word night not just to talk about that time after the sun goes down, but also he uses it to speak of something that takes place spiritually. He used it in the life of Nicodemus. The Bible says Nicodemus came at nighttime, but what we find out from the context of the story is that Nicodemus was walking in darkness. He lacked understanding. Jesus said, you be the teacher of Israel, and you know not these things? In reality, not only was he not walking at nighttime, literally the sun had gone down, but he was also walking in blindness, and he could not see properly the things of God. In this passage of scripture, what we see is, yes, it's nighttime. They're toiling, they're grinding, they're working really, really hard, but they're not accomplishing anything. And then, even when the morning starts to come, the day is just starting to break, starting to be able to see just a little bit on the shore over there. They can't recognize him at first, but then all of a sudden, there's a revelation that's given to them. And I need you to understand that that's exactly what Jesus' purpose and ministry was to come to this earth, the light that comes into the midst of darkness. And there's repeated scriptures that I had written down, but I'm not, you know, we don't have to turn each one, but I mean, she's probably faster than I am. But Luke chapter 1, verse 78. Whenever John the Baptist's father began to give a prophecy, he's talking about what John the Baptist was going to do. He was going to prepare the way for the Messiah that was coming. And one of the things that he said was, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high has visited us. The idea of a day spring is when the sun rises. But what he's talking about is this, is that he's talking about the spiritual sun rising, bringing light, bringing illumination, being able to make one see. Anybody that understands the physiology of the eye, without light, you cannot see. It requires the refraction of light in order to be able to see the object that's ahead. And what we need is the Holy Spirit to give us a revelation of what it is that Jesus has come to do. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. In that passage of scripture, Peter says, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shines in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts." Another reference to the sun, the day star, talking about the sun rising, bringing light, bringing illumination. Listen to me. You can be a Christian and have been saved, and you think that the light's turned on, but the reality of it is that you need a revelation from the Holy Spirit of who Jesus was and what Jesus did. Now, I can't tell you how many times I've been preaching this message called the cross, Jesus Christ and Him crucified, the new covenant, the finished work of Christ, the sacrifice of the Lamb. I don't care what you call it. It's talking about the finished work of the anointed one and the whole work that he came to accomplish. I've been talking to people for years that say they've been watching this ministry, listening to that, and reading. Oh, I know all about that. I know all about the cross. No, you don't. You don't even have the first clue. You might have had a bunch of head knowledge. You might have listened to a whole lot of preaching, but the reality of it is that no, you have not received a revelation from God. Until the revelation of the Holy Ghost shows up in the midst of your heart and opens your blinded eyes to what God's plan was and what God's covenant was, then you are still walking in a little bit of darkness and you can't see as clearly as what you need to see. Lord, give us a revelation. Amen. Let us see your will, your plan. The next scripture I wanted to give you was Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18. This is one of my favorite scriptures, really. The Apostle Paul writing to the church of Ephesus. And he says to them, that the eyes of your understanding would be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. I know I've said this many times, but I just love it. The first time I read that, the Lord gave me a revelation of it. It's like, I didn't know that my understanding had eyes. He's trying to make a point. Our understanding, that part in our spirit man, to be awakened to the things of God, that we would have a revelation of God and how he works upon this earth. When the morning came, they saw him. When the light came, they were able to see him. Many times when we find ourselves in a situation like Peter, we find ourselves struggling, we find ourselves frustrated because things aren't going our way. Many times it's because we don't have a revelation of who God is and what God's done. Amen? And I can tell you that that's been a prayer of many a saint's hearts. Many a saint, I can't tell you the people that I've ran into through the years that have said, dude, I prayed a prayer. And I said, Lord, I need revelation. I need to see more clearly your plan. Lord, I need revelation of your word. Lord, show me a preacher. Show me a teacher. let me see. Give me your word that I might be able to see. I can't tell you how many people I've run into over the years that have prayed a prayer like that. Amen? So that's what we need. That's the first thing we need. If we're going to come to the end of ourselves, we need to be able to see him. Amen? Praise God. Hey, Troy, would you turn up that air conditioner a little bit? Beth, would you want to turn it up? Oh, never mind. I'll get it. That's all good. You stay right there. You relax. I tell you what. These air conditioners will be working better because I used to put it like on 69 and y'all look like y'all about to freeze at 71. Yeah. Anyway, that's another story. All right, point number two. The scripture says right here in verse 6, he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Point number two is you got to do it his way. And what we see is that we've already pointed out that the disciples have made a choice to go back to doing things their own way, things that are, and it's contrary to what God's plan is for them. And in our work, walk with God, we oftentimes find ourselves, like them, toiling and grinding and working, but yet no fruit. No fruit in our lives spiritually. No fruit in our lives financially. No fruit in our lives for the things that we've been praying for. And we don't understand why. And what I want you to know is this, is that it's because we're not doing it his way. Amen. God has one specific way, and that's the only way. But not only that, and what is that way? Well, it requires faith. And we've talked about that many times. Faith in Christ and keeping it there and the resultant flow of grace that comes into our life. But as that happens, the Holy Spirit also speaks to us and gives us direction and guidance on where he wants us to go. And he's desiring for us to walk according to what it is that he's speaking to us. In John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8, Jesus says in verse 1, he says, I'm the true vine. I mean, that could be, excuse me, another way to say I'm the true way. He said it, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'm the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, first of all, you know, the question that you have to ask yourself is, how did you get, because he goes on to say that I'm the vine, you're the branch, and that you have to abide in him. How was it that you found yourself abiding in the vine of Jesus Christ? And once again, it goes back to his death, his burial, his resurrection from the dead, and your faith in that. When you place your faith in Jesus Christ and what he did for you at the cross, that supernatural miracle took place when the old man died of Adam, a new man was resurrected, and I tell you, it was a beautiful picture that the Lord gave me one time of how his side was pierced. I think this is good stuff right here. His side was pierced, and just as you graft a branch into a tree, that's what has to happen. You got to cut a hole in the tree, and you stick a branch in there. His side was pierced, amen, and it's as though God inserted a bride in his side, amen, and it's a Gentile bride, because there's also the scripture where Paul talks about the fact that we weren't the natural branch, but that we were a wild branch that was grafted in. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that it's faith in Christ and what he did that allowed you to be grafted into the vine, and now you have to abide there, amen? And he goes on to say right here, he says that now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine. No more can you except ye abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. They've gone on a fishing trip. I go a fishing. I'm going to go back to the way things used to be. Jesus isn't in the boat with them at that point in time. They're toiling, they're working, they're trying to accomplish something, and they're coming up empty. There's no harvest in the boat. And it's because they're not doing it the way the Lord wanted them to do it. And so he tells them, he goes on to say here, that at the end of John, well, in John chapter 15, verse 8, I believe it is. He says, "Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples." You know, I really haven't made this point, but this whole passage of Scripture has to do with the fact that Jesus called them to be fishers of men. Now he's saying in John 15 that "Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples." That's a big difference between the message that we would preach, and we will always preach as long as I'm behind this pulpit in this church. The big difference between this and the modern church. The modern church really wants to give you a good practical message to try to tell you how you're going to make your life a little bit better today. Talk to you about your bills and all that kind of stuff, and your relationships and various things that you have on your mind and on your heart. In reality, what the gospel keeps telling you is you need to lose your life so that you can gain it, and you need to be focused upon the will of God, and that you need to be a fisher of men in your own way, and that you need to glorify the Father by bearing fruit. Amen. And that fruit that we're talking about here, let's not be confused. This fruit that we're talking about is not that we drive a bigger car, that we wear better clothes, but instead the fruit of the kingdom, that souls would be won into the kingdom. That doesn't mean you're going to stand behind a pulpit and preach, but it does mean you will be a witness out there in the world that God has brought you to, and that you will also support the work of God, amen, or works of God that are preaching the truth of the gospel to send the gospel forth. You either believe that it's the God, that the gospel will change people, or you don't. You're either concerned about souls that are lost, or you're not, amen? And so I want you to know that that's what Jesus is talking about. And so, you know, once again, sometimes like the disciples, we think we're headed in the right direction. And they're sitting here working and they're toiling, but they're not accomplishing anything. And I was just thinking about the fact that victory is so close to them. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you think about it, they're over there throwing their net on the left side of the boat. And Jesus just makes one simple proclamation. Try the right side. They change direction. Amen. It's just the width of a boat. I don't know how wide the boat is. It's just the width of a boat. The fish aren't here, but the fish are over here. And just by changing direction and listening to the word of God, doing it his way, abiding in him. If you don't abide in him, you're not going to bear any fruit. Apart from him, you can accomplish nothing. He's the vine, you're the branch. To abide there means to dwell there, to live there. It's like we're desiring to hear from you, God. We want to do your will. I know sometimes we get off track. We go in the wrong direction. But we desire to do it your way and to hear your will. Try the right side. A change of direction, amen? And what you're doing ain't working. Sooner or later, you need to change directions. Hallelujah. You need to get smart enough by the grace of God to say, "Hey, I've been rebellious. I've been stiff-necked. I've been hard-hearted and hard-headed. I've been like Simon Peter. I want to do things my way. I don't think you know well enough, God. This not be for you, Jesus." And have my own plans. And the reality of it is that sooner or later, God's saying, "I hope you come to the place where you realize you need to try something different."
Amen.
You need to change directions. You need to throw on the right side. Come on. I mean, even right now as I preach, I know that the message that I just said, it's about you know, spiritual things. It's about fruit. It's about a harvest of souls. It is that. But at the same time, if you think that when you're in covenant with God, that he's not giving you practical wisdom also in your own life. I'm thinking about my own finances right now. While I'm preaching, the Lord is speaking to me saying, "Yep. You got your own situation." We all have our situations in our own house, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
I mean, I need to teach my kids some more revelation about finances, and you know, I need to teach myself and have an understanding. You can't always have everything that you want.
Amen.
I don't care how much money you think you make. I don't care if you get a promotion and you make more money. You keep thinking that you can have everything you want. You ain't gonna have nothing left at the end of the day. We got to start walking with some wisdom. Amen. Yeah. You know, we got to come to the realization that we can't just always have everything that we want. I'm preaching to the preacher. God will give you a revelation. He will speak to you. But until you start listening, it doesn't do any good. Amen.